Good evening, you're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. Now, if a George Bush doesn't read the newspapers, why should we? Do you think that the newspapers in this country are so scared of being overtaken by new media that they've given up their independence, their integrity to make money? Have the business people taken over the newspapers? Here to discuss that question tonight is Ken Auletta. Thank you very much for coming
by, Ken.
Auletta. And the reason you're here is you've written a great new book called Backstroke, Inside the Business of News. And I'd like to show that up to the audience. In this book, you are talking about the, let me go through this, Los Angeles Times, the New York Times, the Daily News, the New York Post, the Chicago Tribune, and IMUS and some others.
And Fox News.
And Fox News. And this is a collection of pieces, some of which, but not all of which, have been published in The New Yorker. But it has a new introduction. It has some new pieces, and I want to talk about some of the new pieces. It has 5,000 more words on how it rains, and therefore, everyone should read this book.
Bless you.
It's a great book. Well, let's pick up from the beginning. George Bush, if I can just start there for a moment. It used to be a time when the President of the United States would start every day by reading the Washington Post and the New York Times. Now, according to you, actually, in one of your recent pieces in the New Yorker about the White House, the President of the United States doesn't read any newspapers. Now, does that say more about him, or does that say more about newspapers?
Well, it says more about him and his attitude towards the press. He feels, as he said publicly, that he gets his information from his independent staff. Now, if you really think the White House staff is independent, you haven't been to any White House, and I know you don't think that. But Bush's feeling is that the press gets things wrong, and that the press, he does not accept our role in a democracy, which is the theme of this book. We see ourselves as representing the public interest. He sees the press as representing a special interest. And in this case, the special interest is boost ratings, boost circulation, gotcha, get the sizzle, not the steak. And he resents that so deeply that he actually doesn't read the newspapers. He reads the sports page a little bit, and they say that his wife will tell him if there's anything hot in the news, as will his chief of staff, Andy Card, who he meets at 7 a.m. But essentially, he does not read the newspapers or watch television news.
He didn't even have cable television, as I recall, in Texas when he first was elected.
Well, he probably doesn't have it at his ranch, no. But he certainly has it at the White House, but he's not watching it.
The criticisms that you've said that George Bush may have of the press are ones that we hear a lot. And in fact, they're repeated in your book.
Well, the interesting thing is that Bush's critique of the press actually mirrors the critique of the press one often hears from the left, from Al Franken, let's say. And the interesting thing is that conservatives will tell you they think there's a liberal bias in the press, and Bush believes that. And liberals will tell you there's a conservative bias in the press, Fox News, Wall Street Journal, Limbaugh, and they believe that. But both the left and Bush actually quietly, and they don't even realize it, agree. They both see the dominant bias is not a political bias in the press, but an economic bias, a kind of a market bias, a bias for get those ratings up, get that circulation up, get more gotcha, get more wow, get more people in our tent because we're losing our audience. And Bush would never talk about a market bias because it would sound socialistic to him to say that. But in effect, he and Al Franken are in agreement.
Can we talk about market bias?
Sure.
I mean, your book, as its theme, you might say, in a sense, market bias. I mean, you've got a lot of words for it, including one that's hard for me to pronounce, synergism.
Well, synergy is the favorite catch-all of the new corporate media moguls who rule many journalistic entities.
In your book, you got a great piece that's new to me on the Chicago Tribune, which bought the Los Angeles Times, and the two are sort of...
And Newsday,
which has a local reason for talking about it on this show. Los Angeles Times, why don't we start with that? Because there is the paradigm example of a market-driven newspaper, at least in the public's eyes, because the guy who came in and took over that paper, Mark Willis, he was a public figure several years ago. And what was his theory in taking over the Los Angeles Times?
His theory in taking over the Times, he's a man who had been a Procter & Gamble's, and he didn't come from the world of media or the world of journalism. And he took over the Times Mirror Company. The Chandlers brought him in, the Chandler family, and the flagship of the Times Mirror Company was the Los Angeles Times, also Baltimore Sun, Newsday, and several other newspapers. And he made a deal, which I describe in this book. When I went to see him in 95, when he was talking to me about how he's going to grow the Los Angeles Times and he's going to create synergy and he's going to lower the walls between the business side and the news side, all of which are anathema to journalists. We don't want a lower wall between the ad salespeople and the news people. We want a high wall. Keep them the hell out of the newsroom. But he believed he had to change the assumptions of journalism and make it a better business. And one of the things he did, he made a secret deal with the Staples Center to sponsor a special edition of the Los Angeles Times Magazine, and it was about the Staples Center, but he never told readers or much of the staff that the Staples Center was paying for the self-promotion. And when it came out that that's what happened, the Chandlers were enraged. They felt he had harmed the product, the good name of the Los Angeles Times, and it has a deservedly good name. He was ousted because they went behind his back and sold the paper to the Chicago Tribune Company. So, and all the other papers they own. And so the Chicago Tribune Company now owns not only the papers and the TV stations that they own, but also the old Los Angeles Times. I think the Los Angeles Times, with the new editor and a new team in place, is a better paper today than it was. And I think it has a deservedly good reputation. But the Chicago Tribune Company is one that buys into this business mantra of synergy. And by synergy, what they mean is 1 + 1 = 4, new math. And what they think is that you got to get all divisions of the company to kind of work together and promote each other and lower the walls between divisions. And the problem with that is that the culture of the corporate world of media ownership is a very different culture than the culture of journalism. The culture of journalism is not one of teamwork, it's one of individual effort. It's not one of lowering the walls, it's one of keeping the walls high.
Yeah, there's some magic words here that the Chicago Tribune uses, and one of them you have is synergy, brand.
Extending the brand is a
brand content, partnership. And what do you think about the rest of the words that you haven't talked about already?
Well, what happens is that, you know, when they talk about brand or brand extension, which is another favorite phrase of people in the business world, not just in the media business world. What they mean by that is that it's a familiar brand. People know the name of the company and feel good about it. They have a feeling about it. What I think a lot of these business people often miss is that another word for brand, a synonym for brand, is credibility. That's the word that we would use in the world of journalism. And what happened when the Los Angeles Times got into this controversy and embarrassment with the Staples Center, they harm their brand because they harm their credibility. And one of the ways we have to cross the divide, we journalists, with the business people who sign out checks, right, is to somehow explain to them and convince them that credibility matters. If they cut investigative reporting back, if they cut overseas bureaus, if they cut kind of coverage that gives the credibility of a newspaper, they undermine their brand.
How much do you think the desire for all these magic words to make newspapers content machines? That's another word that we should talk about.
Well, the editor of the Chicago, the former editor, he called himself a content provider.
we got to come back to that. How much do you think all that is driven by fear of new media? You talk about it a little bit in your book. In other words, new media, this show's about starts with new media, then works back into what you're talking about, and so forth and so on, and looks at the impact of new media on our lives. New media, let's say, if you want to talk about the net, leave cable out for a moment, because cable caused a big threat to the newspapers too. But the net comes in, let's say, 1995, and it seems to me a lot of the stuff that you're talking about is post-95. Therefore, there might be some argument that Everyone says, Jesus, they're looking at the net. The net's going to swamp us. We can't do things the old way. We've got to react. Do you think that's part of it?
Oh, I think technology, one of the things that's fundamentally different about the world of media business today from 100 years ago, you've always had change and you've always had technological disruptions, electricity, for instance, you know. The telegraph, for instance, right. The telephone, for instance.
Or television. Right. Television was a big threat on newspapers, knocked a lot of them out in New York City, it might be.
Absolutely. Yeah. And then television was threatened by, television knocked out radio at one point. Right. And then broadcast television was harmed by cable television. Right. And then the internet comes along and harms everyone.
Right.
But so do Game Boys. and other devices. I mean, eventually, you know, your Palm Pilot is going to be, you know, you do email with it as well as telephone calls. And so I can get instant news on that. What has happened in technology to the news business, and it applies to newspapers and magazines and television, is that people can get, they have so many choices, but technology allows them to get instant information that they want and when they want it. And so essentially, the idea that you're going to wait for the morning newspaper or wait for the 6:30 or 7 o'clock evening newscast, or even wait, you know, 24-hour cable news. Yeah. You have to wade through all of it to find out what you want. But on my Palm Pilot or on my PC, I can call up what I want when I want it. And so it empowers me and it gives me much more choice. So one of the things that newspapers wrestle with is, how do I move to the online world so I provide online news? I would love it if I can find an economic model to do it, because it's a lot cheaper than paying for paper and distribution. it's a cheaper way of doing that. On the other hand, outside of the Wall Street Journal, no one has figured out an economic model
New York Times makes money on its economic model. What you were model, but what
but
you were referring to was that the Wall Street Journal, you pay for it. So.
So but they have an audience that could afford to and write it off as a business expense.
All right, so when the content providers of the world, which would mean particularly in our conversation, the Chicago Tribune, which now owns the Los Angeles Times, which now owns Newsday, which used to
own sports teams and radio stations
and
cable,
inside,
local cable stations.
Used to own WPIX here in
still
New York.
Still does.
It still owns PIX here
in New York. Of their hopes is to create synergy between their local TV station and Newsday, moving Newsday into New York City.
Well, when you're a content editor and you have a Chicago Tribune newsroom, how does that work? You sit in a newsroom and you're the content editor, so you say, well, in comes the content. This content's for the net. This content's for cable. How does that work?
Well, he literally, at the Tribune Company, has been a pioneer in this and been very smart in thinking ahead about what the future might be. They have a newsroom, and in the newsroom, they have their radio station person, they have their website person, they have their cable TV person, they have the newspaper person, and they sit there, and information comes in. They don't wait and save it for the next morning's newspaper. They disseminate it all over, and hopefully getting out the brand name of the Chicago Tribune in that will create the kind of synergy they talk about and create more interest in reading.
But what is this synergy that they're talking about? I don't understand it.
Well, it means you might get confused because the word really to you means shilling. But what it means is that if they own Chicagoland, which is a local the equivalent of New York One in New York, it's a local cable news station.
Right.
And on that local news station, they don't spend a lot of money, but they have the food critic or restaurant critic for the Chicago Tribune who comes in. They have the sports writers for the Chicago Tribune come on. So they come on and they are promoting the Chicago Tribune, but they're also appearing on cable. So they're appearing in other venues.
It's
cross-promotion.
It's cross-promotion.
That's synergy. That's a form of synergy.
And as I read this book, you really love that word.
No, actually, I actually hate the word.
You hate the word.
I hate the word, and because to me it often means it's a threat to it's poison.
Okay, well,
to journalism.
Tell us how, in the context of what you described, where we've got the Chicago Tribune, the content provider, that's sitting there with all these people in a circle. I don't know how does it work. But what does it make much difference to you and me who have been inside newsrooms? But anyway, they're all
it's a bigger round table.
They're around this table.
Yeah.
And then they get on each other's media and cross-promote, as you pointed out.
But also, the assumption is it's cheaper to do because I can use the staff of the Chicago Tribune to put information.
Now, why is that bad for journalism?
Well, it may not be bad. Some of it may be good for journalism. Yeah. I mean, from the question, among the many questions you have to ask are the journalists getting paid extra to do extra work? That's certainly one question that journalists ask.
They don't.
Generally do not. Generally do not. And then the question is...
Can I just stop you there? I'm going to come back to this question, but what they get paid and the profit margins. What do you think of the profit margins of, I don't want to pick on the Tribune, but let's take the synergistic paper. Do you think they're... What are they in the first place?
Well, the profit margins of the Chicago Tribune newspapers are in the 20s, which is very high. The highest is Gannett in the industry, generally speaking, though there are others that are monopoly newspapers that make even more, have a higher. And what that means is that on every dollar of revenue you bring in, you're earning a profit of over 20 cents. And the New York Times is probably, I'm guessing, in the 8 cents range, or maybe 10 cent range. And what happens is that increasingly these companies become public. And the people at the top of them judge their success by their stock price and by their profit margin. So profit marginalism, as I call in the book, becomes a real problem because the people who run the company don't come out of the journalistic world, and they're pushing to get that profit margin up to double it, go from 8 to 16, which is what Mark Willis tried to do at the Los Angeles Times. But in order to do that, you've got to make some severe cuts in budget. You got to cut overseas bureaus, you got to cut. And one of the things we editors have to learn how to do with these people to communicate and say, look, you talk at the same time about brand and credibility. If I, in order for me to double my profit margin from 8% to 16%, 16 cents on a dollar of revenue, but I have to cut the bureau and the capital. I can only do one investigative piece a year rather than five. I have to cut from 6 to 4 overseas bureaus. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to sacrifice that? And I don't think you should be willing to do that. We have to do a better job of explaining what the price of achieving that is. But then the problem becomes that how do you change the value system so that the person at the top says, I'm going to tell Wall Street, don't just judge me by an artificial construct of 16% profit margin or 20% profit margin. If you believe that credibility is important to us, and we learn it is every time you have a scandal in journalism, like Jason Blair at the New York Times or the Staples Center at the LA Times, then you've got to allow me some flexibility. I'll get my 20% or 50% on local TV stations is what the profit margins are. Judge me by that, but don't hold it to me in terms of journalism.
In terms of journalism. But it might be that you may have to face up to the fact that the profit margins you described are huge. We don't have to get into the numbers, but they are huge as compared with the average overall company in the United States, the internet companies. You're making a lot of money. You can make a lot of money if you've got talent and you capitalize on it. But generally speaking, in this country, people don't have 20% margins, but the newspapers do. And the TV stations have 50%. Maybe at some point in time, the person you've just described has got to go to Wall Street and say, hey, I'm going to take a smaller margin, but in the long run, I think that's going to be what I should be doing. And then they'll say, all right, we're going to sell the stock off.
Well, that's the problem. But, you know, the truth is that for instance, the New York Times company does just that. At economic downturns, they often put more meat in the stew, is a phrase you're very familiar with from your days at the Times. And that's to the credit of the Sulzberger family, just as it is for the credit of the Graham family in the Washington Post or Dow Jones family at the Wall Street Journal.
Let's go back where we were. We're sitting around this table in the Chicago Tribune content room. I guess you wouldn't call it a newsroom anymore, would you? Well, if he's not the news editor, he's the content editor. We're sitting around.
The editor may call himself content editor, but the people in the newsroom
We're all sitting around here, and I was getting to the question of, you were saying it might be better for journalism, but I let you finish the sentence. What's the real problem overall with this type of sitting around the table synergism?
Well, one of the problems you have is that increasingly, because of technology, printing presses are so sophisticated that you do these zoned editions of newspapers. So you have, literally, you can zone by blocks or certainly by neighborhoods. And increasingly, the Tribune Company, for instance, which is one of the more sophisticated companies at doing this, say we have to get our staff out into the suburban area. And we basically have to have more news about suburban areas because that's where the best, the wealthiest people live, and that's where the those are people the advertisers want to reach. So let's start cutting down on some news about the inner city, because that's not our readers. Yeah. And let's have more news about the suburbs, which is what's happening.
Yeah.
And then when you get more news about the suburbs, as you have the news people and the salespeople in the same office and lower the walls between them, the salespeople have an incentive to say to you, you know, I really want to get an ad from that in our local edition from that restaurant. It would really be great if we had a good restaurant review on that restaurant. And the impulse, the peer pressure becomes one of, let's be a good citizen. Yeah. This is teamwork. And that's not what you want. A journalist who goes out there and reviews a restaurant and tells you truthfully whether he or she thinks it's a good restaurant.
And also you, sitting next to each other, you're going to push toward where the wealthiest people are because
that's the given. That's where you're located.
So that's the whole thing becomes, and what happens to foreign news and all this?
Well, foreign news or overseas news becomes less and less important. Yeah. And yet, when you have 9/11, the American public wakes up and says, which, by the way, they've been asleep too, and they wake up and they say, hey, how come we didn't know about Islam? Where was the press or in the telex?
Where was the press on terrorism before 9/11? Where was the press on Clinton and terrorism?
Well,
you know, I mean, Clinton wasn't too strong in terrorism, but he got a pass. But no one's paying attention. No one pays any attention, maybe because of the reasons you're saying.
I think that's absolutely right. There was a report issued by Gary Hart, former Senator Hart, and former Senator from New Hampshire, I'll remember, Warren Rebman.
Yeah.
They co-chaired a commission that warned about a 9/11 and warned about our vulnerability. It got no coverage in the New York Times or the Washington Post.
No coverage at all?
None.
No.
It may have gotten a little in the Washington Post, a small story, but it was all buried inside. The Times didn't cover it at the time. This was, and most of the press didn't cover it. It wasn't just them.
Yeah.
But these are the best papers that weren't covering it. And much to the consternation of Rebman and Hart.
All right, so now you've painted this picture, what I would call a pap picture, which is to say that what we're going to get is homogenized milk, not very interested, from the pap, so to speak, baby's milk. Doesn't sound that interesting. You've made a case that, consequently, the press misses information. Circulation is down 10% over a period of time of newspapers. You quote the Chicago Tribune people of saying, in effect, well, newspapers are there, you know, we'll give them the back of our hand, but the real drill is out here in new media land. We're going to get lots of money, so forth and so on. So what's going to happen?
Well, first of all, I think you overstate.
I overstate your thesis.
You overstate the press is just going to give pap. I mean, I know.
That's what you're saying. Put it in your own terms.
In my own terms, I think there are a lot of good reporters who wake up every day and try and do an honorable, good job. And they miss some stories like the Hart-Rebman report at the New York Times. But they make up for all the great stories they do. And there are a lot of great reporters on television, et cetera. But the trend line, which is what I'm talking about, is for pap.
I didn't overstate it that much.
No, that you didn't overstate at all. Yeah. I just wanted to qualify it.
Yeah.
And so I worry about that. I mean, I worry that the culture of business and this preoccupation on judging financial success, ratings, circulation, leads people who run these journalistic institutions to panic. And basically say, we got to shout a little louder to get people in our tent. Let's look at this presidential campaign first.
Okay.
If you look at the interview that, say, Diane Sawyer did with the deans, with wife,
Mr. and Mrs. Dean. I didn't see that, by the way. Was it any good?
Well, actually, it wasn't any good, but it wasn't any good for the reason I'm going to say. It was interesting in that you really got a sense of her, and I thought she was actually pretty impressive. But Diane Sawyer kept asking questions like, are you angry? Does he have a temper? Does he ever yell at you? And all these questions that, first of all, for feminists to be asking this question of a fellow feminist,
it just
was unattractive. But in addition to that, it was really driven, one felt, as one watched it. There were very few questions of substance in the hour-long interview. It was driven by a desire that's now inculcated in the culture of too much of journalism for a wow moment, for a gotcha moment, yeah. for getting a headline that everyone in the press will pick up. Uh-huh. And that's ratings driven, that's business driven, right. And that's worrisome.
Well, let's talk about the two media you just talked about, the papers and the over-the-air television. And you're an economic reporter. What are the economic futures of each? In other words, when I said that newspaper circulation is going down 10%, we've talked about the fear. You just talked about the fear of new media. Do you think that newspapers have any future?
I think they do, though I think that you can, ideally, if they could figure out a way to make money off the internet, electronic distribution of the newspaper as well as print distribution, they would enhance their business. So far, we have not come outside of the Wall Street Journal. We haven't come up with a real economic model that shows you can make a lot of money. You can do advertising, but it tends not to be, so far, lucrative.
Can I play gotcha with you a little bit? I mean, your answer in part would be maybe the internet's the future for the papers. Would you say that if they were able to figure it out, that people would turn from reading papers to getting that information on the net?
No, because the portability of a newspaper, you can carry it with you. You can pack it in your case, and it is hard to duplicate. And online reading a newspaper is harder. The screen's resolution is not so good, and if you're reading on a small handheld thing, and you have to wait for it to download and move from page to page.
But there is multiple sources of information not available, so maybe the newspapers don't have.
If you look at the trend line, as you say, circulation is down post-war period. For newspapers, it's not a good trend line.
Okay, so I've got to ask you the last question when we come to the end. If George Bush doesn't read the papers, and after talking with you, do you think we still should?
I do.
You do?
I do, but I think we should read them more skeptically.
More skeptically.
Thanks, Jim.
Ken Auletta.
Enjoy it.
Thanks for coming by.
My pleasure.
And thank you for coming by. And come by next week to learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.